welcome to Hope in Christ Church. Amen. I'm glad it's raining out. It is January the 2nd, and it's a beautiful day the Lord has made for us. And I invite you to pull out one of these bulletins. And is anybody here by mistake this morning? Anyone here by mistake? All right, good. I see lots of new faces. If you're visiting, welcome. If you're just visiting family, it's glad to have you here with us. Those of you who've been gone or with us, it's glad to have you back because you are missed. It's great to be able to hear to worship together in the house of the Lord. Lots to go through this morning. Most importantly, I cannot forget, today, right after church, there is going to be a hospitality meeting. And we also will be taking down the decorations. So if you've been involved in some way, shape, or form, or you would like to get involved with hospitality, today's a great opportunity to do that. We'll be taking down the decorations and meeting some new people. So we are in the need of people to please bring any type of refreshments. So typically after the service, you've noticed there's been a bounty of food and refreshments out there. They're just coming in now. So that is hard to sustain. So if you'd like to be able to contribute that to or enjoy that, please reach out to sign up on that. And the sign up is on the bulletin board to the left, right by the double doors as you come in. So that is important to sustain that. So it is the new year. So that means we resume back to our typical Wednesday night events. That's everything. So if you have breath in your lungs, you have something to do here on Wednesdays. There's something here for everybody. There's also a need for childcare. And something new we're kicking off is, in this flyer here, Mom's Group. That will be meeting in the resource room, I believe. Is that correct, Katie?
Yep.
Oh, right. So that's something new this year. And something new within a few weeks will be the foundations class that will be at the pastor's house. So there is a sign up on the table out back. There is always great discussions, great learnings. I love when I restart reading my Bible, the stuff that I forget or didn't know, the small stuff. So we had an opportunity to discuss and learn with the foundations class with the pastor. The offering box, your envelopes, you have a name. There are names. I see some of you here. You have a name on a box. You can grab these envelopes for your tithes and offerings. If you don't have an envelope, what you can do is grab a box out there, and there's a number on it. There's a sheet of paper. Put your name on that sheet of paper with a number, and when you tithe or give your offering, you can do that. We used to pass a plate. I'm not sure when that'll come back, but you have the opportunity. If you're visiting here today, you don't have to feel obligated to give, but if you choose to give, there's a box here at the back of the room, and also by the double door as you leave. So I just want to say thank you for your faithfulness in giving to the church and to ministries. If you'd like to be able to participate, you can do this with the envelopes. There is a new members class starting up. We're not sure when, but as soon as we know that there is interest, please let myself or any other elder know, or Pastor Steve. Let's see. Next Sunday, Sunday afternoon from the hours of 4 to 6 p.m., the Russells, that's myself and my wife, we are resuming the marriage small group study. That's something we've been doing for years. We need that to grow closer to Christ as we do in marriage. There are two openings. If you're interested, please let myself or Laurie know if you'd like to attend our small group focused on marriage. Boy, is there anything else that I'm... Potluck. We all love potlucks. Potlucks. So there will be a fellowship potluck on Saturday, January the 8th. So see your bulletins for details. And someone had their hand raised. Katie?
Go public today, later on, so you kind of get the first chance. We're in a resource room, so we want to make sure we have enough room. an idea of how many people per month are coming. So you can just message me and let me know, but it will be open to more people tomorrow. So if you want to get on that list, try to do it today.
Great, thank you. So again, if you're new visiting, there's lots to do here. If you want to learn more about who we are at Hope in Christ, our desire is to love God, love others, and to serve the world, and how you can do that with us, partner with us. Will you bow your heads with me, please, as we return back to worship? Heavenly Father, I do thank you for this day that you created for us to set aside our lives and to give you focus. And Lord, we need your help. I need your help in doing so. So I pray that whatever the distractions are that are in my heart, my mind, in this building, in our lives here, that we can just set those aside temporarily. And to help us, Lord, to lift you up and to give you the glory, to worship you, Lord, for who you are, what you're doing, and what you have yet to do within us as individuals in this church and in the world. So thank you, Father, and may you be truly be glorified. In your Son's precious name that we pray. Amen.
We stand as we continue to worship God. Our call to worship this morning is from Nehemiah 9. It says, "Stand up and praise the Lord your God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be your glorious name, and may it be exalted above all blessing and praise.
You alone are your Lord. You made the heavens, even the highest heavens, and all their starry hosts, the earth and all that is on it, the seas, and all that is in them.
You give life to everything, and the multitudes of heaven worship you."
Hallelujah. favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless.
Because you're holding on to us. God, I thank you for that. I pray this.
prayers glorifies you in Jesus' name.
Good morning.
Good morning.
That's a little hard to follow. My name is Paula. I'm here to update you on our mission moment. We have a really gracious group of people here. Last month, we had a collection for the India pastors and their wives to buy fabric to make them suits. We collected $313. Which gets over 30 outfits for these people. John 8:12, Jesus, the light of the world, he spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light to lead you. Yesu Padam and Monica, who are our missionaries in India, were able to take a quick trip here to the United States. There's a Bethany Revival Church that they're part of in Bennington, Vermont. They were able to have a dedication to their building. She wrote to me and said, God has answered our prayers for the future expansion of the Bethany Revival Church. The building that they wanted to buy was sold on December 16th to a Jewish man. On December 23rd, Isaiah, the leader at the Bethany Revival Church, met with a man and shared with him that he had hoped to buy this building and what the hope was for the use of it. On December 25th, the man wrote to him and said, I will sell you this building for your ministry. God's timing is perfect. Please pray for the logistics of this purchase. God is faithful and his timing is always perfect. Pray for the Bethany teams in Germany, Switzerland, Vermont, Austria, and now a work starting in Romania. The theme that Yesu Padam has, God has given him, is the year of fulfillment from 2 Kings 6 and 7. We're excited for all the Lord has in store for us, to fulfill his promises for us in the midst of the extremely adverse circumstances that we are living in. For all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him, amen, unto the glory of God by us. We also had last month a daughter of one of our missionaries, the Dennisons, and her new husband, who were getting ready to go to Word of Life in Brazil. Right after they had been here, the next day they were leaving. They did arrive, and I hit the ground running. She writes to me and says that they are so thankful for the Epsom Bible Church raising the funds for them to purchase a much-needed car. Arthur has already gotten to speak for a youth conference, officiated a friend's wedding, December 27th, do a family camp, and then training and preparation for kids' camp are beginning. Heidi and Arthur will work very closely with the counselors for these camps for weeks. Their prayer need is they need $250 to $300 more in their monthly support. And Heidi is carrying their first baby, so help for her. More to come later.
Good morning. I'm not Pastor Steve. Pastor Steve is not feeling that well, so he asked me if I'd be able to fill in, and I said sure. So here we are. 1 Peter, if you don't turn to 1 Peter with me, my name is Jeff, our one pastor. Jeff, I used to be a pastor, and so we'll see how it goes. 1 Peter. I just want to tell you what happened to me on the way to church this morning, though. We were running low on gas, so I gassed up at the Penguin Station, you know, up there on 106, as you're going towards the racetrack. We turned left up there. Went in the Penguin to gas up, and I got to turn the... How's that? Is that better? That working now, Evan? Did you hear the other stuff that I said?
Yeah.
It wasn't, okay. Anyway, we're at Penguin Gas Station, and this lady was there gassing up an older car, and she got to full, and you know how they used to, they'd snap? The thing snapped, and the gas went up her sweater, and I happened to see it. I said, boy, she says, I'll be all right. So anyway, she heads down the road, and I finished gassing up, start down the road, and her window, she's down the road, stopped, and evidently she had clicked her cell phone, and her whole arm was on fire. She had the window rolled down, she was waving, and I pulled over real fast and stopped to try to help her get her arm off, you know. So anyway, got out everything, we got the fire out and all that, but there was a town cop from Loudoun that didn't know me, spun around, he saw me with a beating on the girl's arm, and he thought I was attacking her, I guess. So he spins around and he draws his gun, and he scared me half to death and said, man, I says, I just, her arm caught on fire, you know, I didn't, and when he finally understood what was going on, he goes back to his car and he brings out his ticket thing, and I says, what's going on? Then I got thinking, oh yeah, she's driving using cell phone, you know. He says, no, that's not it. It's against the law to wave a firearm in the state of New Hampshire. So you don't need to believe anything else I say. I'll be yeah, now you're awake, so we'll just, okay. I'm going to read the first 9 verses of 1 Peter.
You never change,
Pastor. Never change. 1 Peter chapter 1. Thank you, hon. 1 Peter chapter 1. Tremendous epistle written by, the chief apostle, we call him sometimes, 1 Peter. Greeting, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood. May grace and peace be multiplied to you. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope. Isn't that awesome? Born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. Who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, which is more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Isn't that awesome? Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, which is what? The salvation of your souls. Isn't that awesome? The end of it all, it's going to be worth it all, isn't it? Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for your word, and thank you. We're living in a difficult time in our country and throughout the world with all these, the Omicron and all the other variants of this COVID disease, and just starvation in places, fires in places, hurricanes, tornadoes, all kinds of things. And we hear about all of it now with the news media. And it's easy for us to get anxious. So I pray that we can get some comfort from this passage of Scripture. Keep things in perspective and remember that heaven is heaven, and not until then. So open our hearts to your word in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. This is written by Peter. Peter is considering the author. The first Christians who received this letter with a sense of importance that when they knew it was Peter, because they realized Peter was the one who stood up. You know, he denied the Lord 3 times. And he did a lot of things 3 times. and got in trouble and opened his mouth a lot. But at the end of it all, at the end of the chapter, in John chapter 20, three times the Lord said, "Feed my sheep, feed my sheep, feed my sheep." And so even though he'd messed up, as bad as he'd messed up, he still had purpose. God had, and that's always been one of my mottos. I mess up more than anybody else. If you try to do things for the Lord, you're going to make mistakes. And you're going to have some people that are going to get mad at you, and some people, and you're going to feel, well, I ought to just quit. But Jesus says, no, you just keep learning. You keep going. And don't you give up. And that's important. And Peter was like that. He didn't give up. He did what he's supposed to do. And Peter was rebuked more than any other disciple. He denied Jesus. And yet Jesus praised Peter more than any other disciple in Scripture. It's pretty interesting. And when Peter finally, one of the times, a lot of the disciples were leaving Jesus, and Jesus turns to Peter and says, "You going to leave too?" And he says, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we've come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." He just had no place to go. You ever feel that way? Sometimes it's hard to live the Christian life, but where else are you going to go? There's no other place. Nothing else makes sense. And that's the truth. That's the way it is. Let's go to verse 3. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading." But it says it's kept where? Kept in heaven for you. Now I want to ask you a question. Who's the audience? Of course, it's written to all of us. It's written for us. But specifically, it was written for who? When you get up here, it says, "To the elect exiles of the dispersion." If you have the King James, it's a little, "the strangers scattered abroad." Okay, the Apostle Paul was breathing out threatenings and slaughter in Jerusalem before he got saved. So to the point where the Christians, except for the apostles, it says in Acts, except for the apostles, the rest of them took off and left town. This is just too much. And it says, he's writing this now to encourage these people that basically have lost everything. Their faith in Jesus Christ has cost them everything. They're dispersed throughout the whole world. So you ever hear of, you ever go down around town in back of, so I think they're in back of Agway right now, the homeless people? Right? There's homeless all over the place. The Skowhegan Men's Shelter, I think Richard Barry came down here and showed the ministry he has to homeless people. And we all call them, you know, we call them sometimes those kind of people. Guess what? The audience here that Peter's writing to was the homeless. They'd lost their jobs. They'd lost everything. They just took off because they were going to lose their head if they didn't. So let me ask you a question. What's it cost you so far to be a Christian in this country? Anybody here ever suffer? Anybody here ever get smacked in the face because they were a Christian? Billy Graham, on one of the shows years ago, I remember before I was a Christian, listening to Billy Graham. I can't remember if it was Larry King or someone was interviewing him. And he had gotten hit in the face with a pie. And then they were interviewing him afterwards, and they said, "What did you think about that?" Billy Graham says, "That's the best tasting pie I ever had." Because he was thankful he was getting persecuted. If life's easy for you, you might just not be doing everything you're supposed to be doing for the Lord. You know that? If you're living it, and you're talking about it, and you're active and verbal, and, you know, when other people swear, you don't swear, and all those kinds of things, someone's going to persecute you. It may not be, you might not lose your home, but you might lose some friends. Anybody here ever lose a few? Or they think you're a little strange now? It's just the way it is, isn't it? That's the way it's got to be. That's the way it's got to be. I could tell you stories, but I got too much to cover. So number one, this was written to refugees. They lost everything that they had. Lost everything that they had. So number one, the Christian life is not easy. We're guilty, even in our country sometimes, of advertising Christianity as something that's going to solve your problems. And that isn't the case. Sometimes you have more problems. I've got a great theologian named Tim Tradasky over at the Loudon Church. And he says, Jeff, you know, sin just isn't fun anymore. It just isn't fun anymore. And it's true. You can still do it, but the Holy Spirit won't let you be happy and do it. And pretty quick, you're going to come dragging, crawling back and saying, God, would you please forgive me? I'm miserable. If you're living a life and you're still in some kind of a sin, you're miserable. You need medicine for anxiety. You need medicine for ulcers. You'd almost think maybe I know what I'm talking about because I've been there. Okay? It's really true. And that's just the way it is. Let's go down to that inheritance, verse 4. It's imperishable, it's undefiled, it's unfading, it's kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice. Though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials. I attend a support group, a men's group on Monday nights down in Manchester. And we were talking about the consequences of sin. There's also consequences of faithfulness. And what a lot of us try to do is we try to mix the two. And a lot of people have a terrible, difficult life financially, emotionally. Maybe their marriages are messed up and all that, but it's not because they've been faithful. It's because they've been sinful. But throughout Scripture, there are people that were faithful, and it got difficult. You know, faithful. 1 Corinthians 7 says that the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband, the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife. But nevertheless, there are times when if the unbeliever wants to depart, let him depart. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases. Because Christianity can sometimes cost you a marriage. Not that you leave, but they leave. They don't want to be around that. You know what I mean? That's faithfulness, and that's the consequences of being faithful. But most of our situations come as a result of sin rather than faithfulness. Would you agree? For the most part. Well, I was telling the guys down there, a lot of people have summed up a person's life that's been faithful over the years, and they say, you know, he's sacrificed a lot. If you're faithful and you're doing what you believe God wants you to do, I don't find that to be a sacrifice. I find that to be pleasurable, even if it's getting a pie in the face. You know, if you know you're doing it because just serving Jesus. And I had a guy in, I was down one night in Daytona Beach, Florida, on Sea Breeze Boulevard at 11 o'clock at night with Danny DeHart. Some of you know Danny. And Richard Burley, the evangelist Richard Burley, and a bunch of us went down there to just preach in the street. And this guy in a football jersey is watching me, and I'm preaching at a sketchboard on the street. And he told me to shut up. I thought he said stand up. No. No. He says, you shut up. Like, and he's staggering around like this. And he says, I told you to shut up. And I just kept on preaching, you know. And he went right by my face. He missed me. And I'm thinking, okay. A guy out of the crowd that I don't know, some high school kid who was a football player, I found out afterwards, tackled that guy. And down on the ground they went. And wrestled around till the cops came and pulled them apart. And I thought, sure, we're done preaching. The guy said, no, you keep right on preaching. We'll get rid of these guys. And it's just, you never know what's going to happen. But I wasn't sad that that happened. My point is that I've never sacrificed much for Jesus. I really haven't. And sometimes it's the real, when you get into this right here, what he's talking about, you, if necessary, verse 6, in this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various, what? Trials in the ESV. So that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory at the honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. I've never had cancer yet, internally. I just had skin cancer taken off my chin. I had skin cancer taken off my head. They drilled in there and found this great big vacuum chamber and said it was not... You're still awake, okay. But the trial of our faith is when things don't go good. We're living in a world where, could you maybe list off a few things that are challenging our faith right now? Anybody ever, you ever do that? You ever get relaxed enough? This is a small enough group of people, so if someone's really heretical, we'll burn them at the stake and throw them out the door. But anything going on right now that's challenging? Parenting. Culturally challenging?
Parenting.
Huh.
No absolute truth.
What about some things that we're all, in, Christian and non-Christian, are struggling with right now?
Inflation.
What is it?
Inflation.
Inflation. Absolutely. Political unrest. Omicron and Delta and all the COVID-19. Anybody here ever hear of a guy named Elon Musk? Have you listened to any of his stuff about artificial intelligence and what's coming down the pike if the Lord tarries? It's in blow your mind. I challenge you to go on YouTube and look up Elon Musk artificial intelligence and hear what he has to say. And it's like, oh my word. And it's here. It's already here. I drive a car now that if I hit lane assist, I could just kind of relax. And when I get too close to the middle line, it brings me back. And if I get too close to the outside line, it brings me back. And if I get too close to the car in front of me, it slows me down. Already. Right? Anybody here got one of those? It's fairly normal now. Lane assist and all that stuff. And he said in a year and a half, this is just recent. He said he thinks within a year and a half, the machines will be driving our cars. We'll just be sitting in them. Because it's 40% safer to have a machine drive the car than for a human to drive a car. Now, I don't know if that's true or not. He's not a prophet in this Bible that I know of. But I'm thinking to myself, wow. So I'm having a conversation with my son. I went to Tennessee to visit with him over Christmas, before Christmas. And I was telling him that a guy named Rusty and his last name Stratton, we had a visit. We were talking about end times and how there's things going on right now that makes you wonder if this isn't it. For centuries, people have thought, boy, the Christ is going to come here any time. But what are the things going on right now that might make you think that now is the time? That maybe it really is close now? Anybody? Relax, and if you're wrong, we won't laugh at you. Anyone?
The pandemic.
That's right, pandemic. The whole concept in Daniel where it says knowledge will greatly increase, it certainly is exponentially increasing.
Natural disasters,
absolutely. So my son and I'm talking to me and I'm talking that we had talked about, boy, and things seem to be happening with more frequency. You know, it talks about as a woman with labor pains, the things are going to get more increasingly intense, and we're going to hear about more fires and sooner, quicker and all, just like a woman when she has her labor pains and they come with greater intensity and greater frequency. Same idea. That's possible, but my son said, Dad, see, he'd been reading somebody else. And he said, Dad, what if you lived in, what if you got born in 1885? If you got born in 1885, think about what you went through if you live to be 75, 80 years old. Number one, your parents lived through the Civil War. Okay, the Civil War. 65,000 people dying in one day on a field in Gettysburg. Hand-to-hand combat. No CNN, no MSNBC, no news, but it happened, right? Then what do you have in 1918? So you're 35 years old. The Spanish flu is what I was thinking of. I think it was 1918, 1917, 19. Right around the same as the First World War, which was happening. All kinds of people dying, right? And then the war to end all wars, supposedly. And then you have the Spanish flu. Some households, there were like two parents and six kids in a house. And at the end of that flu, there was no one to live in the house. They all died. Think about that. Drive down the road and there's a house that used to have a family in it. And now it's empty. And the bank takes it over, I guess. And yet we're all shook up about Omicron because one in a bazillion dies. I mean, it's not, if you're part of the family of one that dies, that's bad for you. But you follow what I'm saying? And then you have the Second World War and you have Hitler coming and exterminating the Jews. And I said, boy, you know, I hadn't thought about that, Rye. Things could get a whole lot worse.
Amen.
They could get a whole lot worse.
Amen.
Yeah. And that's why, okay, number one, I got to go back and remember what number one is. Number one, as a Christian, life might not get easier. It'll get better. Because better is a quality, but easier is, you know, something that it may not get easier. It may get more difficult in terms of this life. Secondly, and this is huge, trials have a purpose. And these trials might get worse and worse and worse as we go. And I'm convinced that as Christians, especially as Americans, how much time do I have? I don't want to get rolling here too long. I'll just keep going for a few more minutes. I'll stop telling jokes and just preach. No, trials have a purpose. And they're there to test the genuineness of our faith. We have way too much material. One thing I chuckle at, you know these storage units? They're springing up all over the place. There's one over on Route 4 now, and I'm thinking, who has stuff enough to put in those storage things? And then I got thinking, wait a minute, I've got a barn. 3 floors and 2.5 of them are full already. You know, stuff. You know what I'm saying. It's real easy to get materialistic in our culture because we can. And these people were no different. They would have if they had the opportunity. But they'd lost everything. And at the same time, even though they've lost everything, he says you keep it in perspective. And when it comes to the sin issues, the testing of our faith can change our behavior. When it comes to living faithfully, the testing of our faith can prove to you, especially to you, you know, Paul said, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. Examine yourself to see whether or not you are in the faith. It doesn't hurt sometimes to ask a question, am I really saved or not? I say it, but am I living it? And thirdly, I just want to say this, that heaven is going to be in heaven, but heaven is not now. Okay? Heaven is yet future. Verse 8. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, which is future, right? The complete salvation. We get salvation of our soul when we get saved, that's true, but the actual ultimate whole package comes when we get to heaven, right? Trials will be over. And the faithful will be in heaven. So I want to ask you a question. Where are you at with all this, personally? Are you suffering anything at all for your Christianity? I mean, you might be suffering stuff because of your behavior, your bad behavior, right? You might be you just can't stop spending, and now you have plastic in your pocket, and you got to go in someplace, and you smell the smells, and you fall to the stuff, and you end up with bills you can't pay. That's not Christianity. That's not suffering. That's not a trial for Christianity. That's a discipline, right? No chastening, for the time seems to be joyous but grievous. Nevertheless, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those of us who learn by it. Right? But where are you at with your Christian faith? What's it cost you? You don't need to answer that. You just let the Spirit of God crank on you a little bit. You know? Are you thinking that this life has to be easy? Are you running away from faithfulness because you compromise makes it easier? I challenge you to be faithful. We're supposed to be the salt of the earth, but if the salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall the earth be salted? We're supposed to make a difference in the way we live. And believe me, when I'm pointing at you, the tree coming back at me, okay? It's real easy for me to isolate. I now have an excuse, right? COVID. I don't have to go out and preach now. I can stay home because there's COVID. I can keep my mouth shut, you know, and just behave myself and do some projects and look at my progress and feel good about myself because I know how to sand sheetrock or something. But it's all going to burn. It's all going to burn. Only one life, it will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your word, and thank you that the Holy Spirit does his job in us as we use the word. Just help us to help each other to be faithful. Those that are learning the hard way from their own behavior, to hold up under it. No chastening seems to be joyous but grievous, but let them endure that and change their behavior. But Lord, the other side of that trial is, what have I really sacrificed? What have I really sacrificed for my faith? Am I really faithful, or am I a compromiser? Help me to really think about that today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning, Hope in Christ Church. It's great to be in the house of the Lord today, isn't it? Just a brief announcement here for those of you that are watching from home. You can put your prayers and praises in through prayerchain@hicnh.com if you'd like to do that. And for those of you here, if you don't feel like putting your hand up, just find a card like this in the seat in front of you, on the back of the seat in front of you. You can fill it out and drop it off in the offering box in the back of the sanctuary here. So, this is a very important part of our worship service, and I know that a lot of you have some praises, and I'd like to just ask to bring forward any praises you may have, stuff that came up this week. Yes, Steve? I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you. Oh, for the for the praise team, yeah. Thank you. Any others? It's Mike.
Back earlier this winter, I guess about a month ago, we had a very minor snowstorm, and it caused a little bit of damage to my electrical system outside, and I had the same thing happen last year. And I paid an electrician $2,000 to repair it. So I was assuming that I had kind of the same problem. I talked to Pastor Steve, and he said, no, I don't think it's that big of a deal. And it turned out he was right. He doesn't do that kind of work, but I did contact a guy that came. And it was 300. So that was a huge prayer relief. Great.
Yeah, great.
Thank you, God.
Great. Anybody else? I know I have a praise. I know that you, many of you are praying. My back was out, and you know the Lord healed me. Debbie and I are calling it a Christmas miracle, but I really appreciate your prayers. And God's healing for me. How about some more? Yes.
Jeff and I and my mom and my aunt all came to know the Lord January 4th, 1999. on January 7th of 1978. So we have spiritual birthdays this week.
Oh, great. Wow. Well, that's awesome. It's a good thing to celebrate, isn't it? So we have spiritual birthdays for our family. Praise for the praise and worship team up here. And Mike had some electrical issues that were resolved without too much cost for him. So this is another praise. Any others? Yes.
I'd like to praise the Lord for the opportunity that my wife and I had this past week to connect with some brothers and sisters in Christ that we haven't seen for a while, and it's just nice to experience that common bond and the friendship that remains. Yeah. And it was really a blessing.
Great, thanks. Anybody else? Well, great. We have another praise that for just fellowship with Christians. It's just good sometimes to meet Christians. You know, we're often a minority in places that we go, but it's always nice when we work with Christians or we run into other Christians that we know in the world. So, with that, why don't we go to our prayer part of the service? Any prayer requests today?
Can I say something?
Yes.
Because I put a lot of time in the Marine Corps, but today I'm really upset about our country and the direction that it's going. And we need to pray for the good Lord to save our country.
Yes.
To be our Savior. And because of the direction it's going, I'm really, really I'm older right now, but I'm worried about my grandkids and the younger children. They're the ones that's going to be suffering what's going to take place. And I can go on and on about this because I know a lot, you know, because I keep up with it, my military. And we're not in a very, very strong military right now. Our security is gone. And every morning, first thing I do, well, first of all, I say, thank you, Jesus, for this beautiful day. It's another gift for me. But I also say, please, Father, you're our Savior, and I beg you, my Lord, please help our country. Don't, you know, don't let it go in the direction it's going. And so I'm asking everybody, pray every morning to the good Lord and ask him to save our country.
Amen. You
know? Amen.
So, thank you very much for your time, sir.
Sure. We have a prayer request for our nation and our nation's leaders as well. You know, it's biblical for us to pray for our nation's leaders, and it's something that we really need to do. You know, there's, you know, the battles that we fight are spiritual battles. And, you know, Satan is certainly working against Christianity in our nation, the way things are going. So we'll keep that in our prayers as well. Other prayer requests? Okay, well, why don't we go to the Lord in prayer then? Dear Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord, for being able to come to you in prayer, Lord. It's an awesome blessing, Lord, for us to be able to pray to you, Lord, and to have our prayers answered, Lord. We thank you and praise you for that, Lord. Lord, I do like to, we'd like to lift up our nation, Lord, and our nation's leaders, Lord. Pray, Lord, for your guidance for them, Lord. And that you would protect us, Lord, and protect our liberties in this country, Lord, and protect our abilities, Lord, to serve you freely, Lord. And pray, Lord, that this would be something that we would not lose, Lord, and that you protect it for us. Heavenly Father, there are many needs in our church, Lord, for our families and friends, Lord, for healings, Lord, for spiritual blessings and guidance, Lord. We pray that you'd be with each one of those, Lord, individually, Lord, and that you would provide hard for their needs. Pray, Lord, for our pastor and his wife, Shirley, Lord, that they could be healed from COVID, Lord. I pray that Shirley wouldn't get it, Lord, but you'd heal the pastor quickly, Lord. There are other pregnancies in our church as well, Lord. We ask you to be with each one, Lord. I pray, Lord, for healthy moms and healthy babies as well. Lord, there are a lot of individual requests on our prayer list, Lord. And I ask you, Lord, that you would be with each one specifically, Lord. Pray, Lord, for your guidance and healing, Lord, for those who are struggling with addictions. Lord, I ask you, Lord, to watch over our ministries, Lord, and our leaders and elders, the parents, and for spiritual guidance, Lord, that you would help us, Lord, to serve you well, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that what we do here in our church, Lord, be glory and honor to you, Lord. I ask you to just be with us, Lord, and protect us, Lord, with these spiritual battles that we face every day, Lord. I ask you, Lord, that you'd give us the strength and the guidance and the perseverance, Lord, and that we could all stay focused, Lord, on your word, Lord, and your will for us in our lives, Lord. Protect us from evil and keep us in your will, Lord. Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise you, Lord, for your many blessings and for your grace and mercy. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Say, Lord, I've sinned. I'm a sinner.
Yes.
And I believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for me. And I repent. I change. I metanoia. I change my mind about my sin. I agree with God. I'm sinful. I need to be saved from my sin. You'll never be perfect, but you can be a long ways from what you used to be. And when you truly believe Jesus died on the cross and rose again from the grave, the Bible says, Jesus said, a man is passed from death to life. That's the future for the Christian. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for your people. Thank you for a good day in the house of the Lord. And we just pray, Steve, Pastor Steve will get his strength back and be feeling better. And commit our week to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Have a great week.